for a long time, and I thought, Sing Sing, Sing Sing. And I thought, Prisoners. So I wrote a song called Prisoners of Love.
Prisoners of Love is a very sophisticated song. It's harmonically sophisticated. And I said, out of the rise in the male voices, then you have to go into something equally thrilling. It was fun to do. But you understand, that's all construction.
Prisoners of love, blue skies above, 'cause we're still prisoners of love.
I want everything I've ever seen in the movies.
Leo, say you'll join me.
I'll do it!
Lincoln Center was the great thrill of my life at that time. It was the last day of filming. We got there just as the sun was going down to set up. And when the water shot up from the fountain and I was running around, I said, I'd like to do this for the rest of my life. It was a great scene to do, and we didn't finish until just about when the sun broke through. And we all went to breakfast at the Brasserie. We had bacon and eggs. That was the last scene in the picture.
For some reason, I don't know, it was crazy. They did no advertising. AFCO Embassy did absolutely zilch when it came to advertising. So there was one small ad, I guess in the Philadelphia Inquirer, that said, the producers starring Zero Mostel and Gene Wilder. They never heard of these people. They had to come to New York to see Zero. And nobody ever heard of Gene Wilder. And Mel Brooks's, nobody ever heard of that guy either. The producers at the Lane Theater. Lane Theater, it was like a big Lowe's or RKO. It held about 3,000 seats. We should have played in a 100-seater. So we came to this enormous theater. No one was there. There was a bag lady asleep in the second row with a bottle of booze near her face like a baby's bottle. Joe Levine was there with two executives. One bag lady, seven people in a 3,000-seater. This movie is not doing well at all, you know. The bag lady woke up during Springtime for Hitler and laughed her head off, which was very nice. Either she got it or she was crazy and drunk. I don't know, but it was a pleasure to hear her laugh. Levine and his guys didn't laugh, and they didn't wait for the credits. They were sitting down front, and we were in the back, so when they passed us, there was no good night. There was no, I'll see you in New York, and, you know, let's figure out what we could do with the picture. And there was nothing. It was just coldness up the aisle.
The people from Embassy Films all got in the limousine and left. And so then there we were, and we finally found a drugstore with a phone and called a cab and got to the train. And now it was very late at night, and we're on the train going back to New York. And the world is, you know, going by, and it's very dark out the window. And we're very, very depressed. And there were these other guys in the train who had come down to Philadelphia to see Gorilla Monsoon wrestle, and they were doing wrestling holds in the aisle.
I thought, okay, maybe there was a career for me somewhere. It certainly wasn't in the movies, I knew that. This was the last movie, first and last movie I'd make. When I got back that night, my wife said, you're white, what happened? And I explained slowly. And I couldn't sleep, and we stayed up reading to each other all night from different books just to get through the night. It was the worst night of my life.
In 1967 or so, I wrote with Larry Tucker, my partner, I Love You, Alice B. Toklas. Peter Sellers read it and decided he wanted to do it. And during the making of the picture, Peter Sellers came to me one day and said, you know, Paul, I'm very lonely out here. It's lonely. There's nothing to do here at night. It's such a strange city. I would like to start a film club, a film society. We'll meet every Tuesday or Wednesday night at the Charles Adakoff Studios. And each week, we'll show a film of one person's choice. And to go with it, we'll have the food of that film, the food of that country. I'd like to start with Padma Panchali, Satyajit Ray's Indian film, and I will bring the tandoori chicken and all of the Indian curries and condiments to go with it. So we have the first showing of Pather Panchali. He brings the Indian food. We all get a little stoned on Alice B. Toklas brownies. We have a great time. It's just great. Laughing our heads off and enjoying the movie, which I had seen, but it was even better the second time. When it was over, Peter said, well, what will we see next week? And I said, well, have you ever seen Vitelloni? Vitelloni? I don't think I've ever heard of it. Fellini's Glee Vitelloni. It's a masterpiece, Peter. Masterpiece? Fellini? Vitelloni? I can't wait. And I said, I'll bring a La Scala hors d'oeuvres. And my wife said, I'll make some spaghetti. He said, I can't wait. Vitelloni, hors d'oeuvres, spaghetti. Oh, I'm so happy. So the next week, we all get there to the Ada Cuff Studios. And we are having the brownies, and we're getting kind of loaded. My wife's got a big black pot of spaghetti she's made. I've got all these hors d'oeuvres from La Scala. And Peter finally says, well, let's see the Vitelloni. And he says, Charles, we're ready for the Vitelloni. And he hits the squawk box. And there's no answer for about 10 seconds. And then you hear Ada Cuff says, Mr. Sellers, I ain't got no Vitelloni. What's a Vitelloni? Vitelloni, Fellini's Vitelloni. And I suddenly realized I didn't bring the film. I thought they would have ordered it. He says, there's no, what's happened? And my wife said, does anybody want any spaghetti? And she picks up the cup. He says, I don't want any spaghetti and I don't want any Vitelloni. Ever, ever, ever. I don't want it. Ever. And just then you hear the voice come out of the squawk box saying, I ain't got no Vitelloni, but I got some movie here. I don't think I'm supposed to show it, but who's going to know? It's something by this guy, Mel Brooks. It's called The Producers. Put it on, as long as it's not Vitelloni. Don't care what it is. Put it on. And the movie goes on. And as the movie unfolds in the first 5 or 6 minutes, we're on the floor. It's hilarious. Zero Mostel. Gene Wilder on the floor. Well, the movie ends, and it's a masterpiece. The lights come up, Peter's in the back, he opens a little book that he has and he starts dialing the phone. It's midnight in L.A. Hello? Hello, Joe. I know, it's 3 o'clock in the morning, I'm Peter Sellers. I've just seen the greatest film ever, ever, ever. It's even better than Fellini's Vitelloni. It's a film called The Producers and you're the producer. It's by Mel Brooks. It's a work of genius, Joe, and I'm taking on full page ad in both trades tomorrow. Sorry to have woken you, thank you. That's the story of how Peter Sellers saw The Producers. He did take the ads out the next day.
Little by little, I don't know what happened. Sidney Glazer was great. He demanded that the movie be released as per contract. So it had to be released at least in one prime theater in one major city. So in New York, Joe Levine had a deal with the Fine Arts Theater on 58th Street. I believe it was in February. And lo and behold, there was a line around the block. Somehow the word had gotten out that this was a very special movie and that New Yorkers would like it. And it was a hit. And it ran for 1 year at the Fine Arts Theater. And it ran for close to a year at 9000 Sunset Boulevard. And it ran in Chicago. Those are the three cities. It was an instant hit and kept running. The critics in New York didn't like the movie much. There was a guy in Time magazine that liked it, and there was Gene Shalit. Gene Shalit, the critic then for Look magazine. He loved it. He said, I'll never forget his review. No one will be seated in the last 88 minutes of The Producers. They'll all be rolling around on the floor. It was a great review.
Congratulations! Have you seen the lines at the box office? It's a torrent. It's an avalanche. It's the biggest hit on Broadway.
We went to the Academy Awards. I couldn't believe it when I won. I never expected it. I was up against all these heavyweights. And when Frank Sinatra said in the winner, Mel Brooks, I couldn't believe it. I didn't even have a speech. I had no speech. I got up and I said, I must tell you what's in my heart. And I just said, ba-boom, ba-boom, ba-boom. I just did this comedy bit. And I thanked a few people and didn't thank enough people because I was unprepared, flustered. But it was amazing. It was, there was the Oscar for best screenplay.
I picked the wrong play. the wrong director, the wrong cast. Where did I go right?